On Sunday, voters in Belarus head to the polls in the most contested election there in decades. President Alexander Lukashenko has been called Europe's last dictator. He has led Belarus with an iron fist for 26 years, accused of human rights abuses, stifling dissent, and running sham elections. But he now faces an unprecedented challenge. And as Nick Schifrin reports, the opposition is led by women who have taken up the mantle of resistance.
Привет, Минск!
In Belarus, behind every good man is a better woman, in this case, three of them. Veronika Tsepkala, Maria Kolesnikova, and Svetlana Tsikhanouskaya, three women who just a few months ago were in the background, now saluted as superheroes, taking on Europe's longest-serving leader.
The government got rid of strong candidates, but they didn't know. Every strong man has a strong woman that supports him.
37-year-old Tsikhanouskaya was a former English teacher and homemaker who was married to an opposition politician running for president when he was arrested in May in broad daylight. Now, as a presidential candidate herself, Tsikhanouskaya is trying to turn her husband's moment into a movement with the help of Kolesnikova, who managed the campaign of another opposition candidate before he was arrested, and Tsepkala, who managed the campaign of her husband, an opposition candidate forced to flee the country with their children. Together, they've helped inspire the largest protests in decades and called for a national reckoning.
As long as I can remember, I have been living a lie. This endless lie. I want this lie to finally end.
I am tired of being patient. I'm tired of being silent. I am tired of being afraid. And you? Are you tired of being patient?
The three of them together have just mobilized the Belarusian people like we've never seen before.
Matthew Rajansky directs the Wilson Center's Kennan Institute. He says the government's targeting the original male opposition candidates helped crystallize longstanding anger.
They became political martyrs, being arrested, being pushed out of the country. That was obviously a slap in the face of the Belarusian people. Time when you run this kind of, you know, a tight-fist authoritarian regime and you leave no room for dissent, no room for people to voice their opposition in a meaningful way, you know, almost any pressure release valve is going to get a lot of pressure coming through it.
Alexander Lukashenko took power in 1994, only 3 years after the country's independence from the Soviet Union. He was elected on a platform of anti-corruption. But his critics called him a European dictator, rigging elections and enabling widespread graft. For months, protesters sick and tired of authoritarian governance and a weak economy wielded slippers to squash a president they called a cockroach. Police responded in force. Plainclothes officers detained journalists and activists and made widespread arrests. Last week, authorities also arrested Russian mercenaries, accusing them of terrorist attacks to destabilize Belarus. But days later, Lukashenko promised allegiance to Moscow.
Russia has always been and will always be our closest ally, no matter who is in power in Belarus or Russia.
COVID has further eroded public trust. Belarus has one of Europe's highest per capita infection rates. Lukashenko eventually tested positive, but at first he called the virus a psychosis and said it was treatable with vodka and saunas. And at a crowded hockey game, he denied its existence.
I don't understand. There are no viruses here. Did you see any of them flying around?
Individual Belarusians came to the rescue.
We tried to survive. We are really interesting. We help each other.
Anna Gorchakova is the director of the Belarusian Children's Hospice. She contracted COVID and told me conditions in the hospital were so bad she had to help other patients. Civil society groups like #BuyCovid19 prepared meals for poorly supplied healthcare workers and gathered supplies for overwhelmed hospitals. The shortages cemented anger at an ineffective government.
And now is the time to think who I am, what I want. I'm ready to change country. I'm ready to change health system.
Early voting's already underway. And despite the opposition's momentum, Lukashenko controls the election apparatus and is expected to be declared the winner. The extent of protests will determine what comes next.
If you have tens of thousands of people pouring into the streets in Minsk and in the major cities across Belarus, that's when I might expect him to turn out the Belarusian paratroops and the Belarusian riot police en masse.
Whether or not it's the end of the line for Lukashenko, for Belarusians, there's hope in the first real alternative in decades. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.